So because we only made it through the first 9 verses last week, I'm going to start reading at Jonah chapter 1, verse 1, and with minimal commentary, and then get into what we're going to look at today. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, "Arise and go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it." So get up, go out, and cry out. "For their wickedness has come up before me." But, or instead of doing that, Jonah arose to flee to Tarshish, which is 2,500 miles in the opposite direction. And he does this to flee from the presence of the Lord. So he went down to Joppa. He found a ship going to Tarshish. And so he paid the fare and went down into it to go with them to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. But the Lord sent out a great wind on the sea, and there was a mighty tempest on the sea, so that the ship was about to be broken up. Then the mariners were afraid, and every man cried out to his God and threw the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten the load. But Jonah had gone down into the lowest parts of the ship and had laid down and was fast asleep. So the captain came to him and said to him, "What do you mean, sleeper? Arise, call on your God. Perhaps your God will consider us so that we may not perish." And the mariners said to one another, "Come, let us cast lots that we may know for whose cause this trouble has come upon us." So they cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. Then the mariners said to Jonah, "Please tell us, for whose cause is this trouble upon us? What is your occupation? Where do you come from? What is your country, and of what people are you?" And Jonah said to them, "I am a Hebrew, and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land." Then the mariners were exceedingly afraid and said to Jonah, "Why have you done this?" For the men knew that he fled from the presence of the Lord because he had told them. Then they said to him, "What shall we do to you that the sea may be calm for us?" For the sea was growing more tempestuous. And he said to them, "Pick me up and throw me into the sea. Then the sea will be calm for you, for I know that this great tempest is because of me." Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to return to land, but they could not, for the sea continued to grow more tempestuous against them. Therefore, they cried out to the Lord and said, "We pray, O Lord, please do not let us perish for this man's life, and do not charge us with innocent blood, for you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you." So they picked up Jonah and threw him into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging. Then the men feared the Lord exceedingly and offered a sacrifice to the Lord and took vows. Now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and 3 nights. Then Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from the fish's belly, and he said, "I cried out to the Lord because of my affliction, and he answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol I cried, and you heard my voice, for you cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the floods surrounded me. All your billows and your waves passed over me. Then I said, 'I've been cast out of your sight, yet I will look again toward your holy temple.' The waters surrounded me even to my soul. The deep closed around me. Weeds were wrapped around my head. I went down to the moorings of the mountains. The earth with its bars closed behind me forever. Yet you have brought up my life from the pit, O Lord, my God. When my soul fainted within me, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer went up to you into your holy temple. Those who regard worthless idols forsake their own mercy. But I will sacrifice to you with a voice of thanksgiving. I will pay what I have vowed. Salvation is of the Lord." And so the Lord spoke to the fish, and it vomited Jonah onto dry land. I don't know that we'll see the end of chapter 2 this morning, but I wanted to make sure that you had as much of the story as possible as we began today. Let's go back to chapter 1, verse 9. The mariners are quizzing Jonah to find out who he is and where he's come from, because as they cast lots, the lot fell on him. That would be of a miraculous origin, God wanting to identify Jonah to the other sailors. There's no place to hide when you belong to God. And God is going to reveal to these unbelievers who Jonah is. And so he does that through the casting of lots. So the response to Jonah is, so they ask him all these questions, and Jonah responds to them, verse 9, and he says, "I am a Hebrew, and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land." And that's where we concluded our Bible study last week. Now, the men's response to this, verse 10, they were exceedingly afraid. So these are hardened sailors. You're hearing me refer to them as mariners, because I'm not wanting to use sailors and make us think that these guys have a sailboat and go out on Saturday morning. This is their career. They're mariners. This is what they do. So not only are they facing this storm that is physically affecting them and affecting their ship as well, but there's a spiritual storm that's happening on the ship as they're recognizing this miraculous direction of the lots to fall on this man, Jonah, and then this testimony of who he is and who he belongs to and what his role is. Remember, Jonah is a prophet. He has prophesied prior to this. He is a man of God. He's living in rebellion to God, and so he's dealing with the consequences from God for that rebellion. So these mariners, they were exceedingly afraid. And they said to Jonah, verse 10, "Why have you done this?" For the men knew that he fled from the presence of the Lord because he had told them. Again, we're so greatly impacted by the fact that these mariners are pagans. They don't have a relationship with Jehovah God. They're not the chosen people of God. They're not saved, to use that word in this way, for the Old Testament. These are pagans, and they're looking on at Jonah, and they're hearing what they're saying, and Jonah has communicated to them that he's fleeing from the presence of the Lord. He's been right out there with that. And isn't it amazing, when we're fleeing from God, when we're living in rebellion, we become so blinded to God's will for our lives. Our ears become so stopped up to hearing the Spirit of God, either by his still small voice or by somebody who loves us and loves the word who's speaking into our life, that we can just be out there with our sin. We've lived with it so long, it's hardened our hearts so much. Well, I told him a thing or two. Or I'm never going to do that. Oh, I don't know what's wrong with that church. I don't know what's wrong with those Christians. And we poison the minds and the hearts of those around us, not even recognizing that we're living in sin and rebellion to God, and that we're speaking it out of our mouth because our sin and our rebellion has just deafened us to hearing that still small voice. Jonah was upfront about his disobedience to God. Put it right out there. It gives us an opportunity to assess and evaluate. What about me? Am I right up front there about my disobedience to God? Do I make sure that I let all my girlfriends know that I've got my husband wrapped around my finger and he's going to do what I want, when I want, and how I want? Do I let it know to my male friends that I run my home with an iron fist? And everybody bows to me. I'm living in disobedience to God as a child of God, and I can't hear the communication of my own sin and my own rebellion. Look at these men in their fear. They're exceedingly afraid. They said to Jonah, "What shall we do to you that the sea may be calm for us?" So they recognize clearly that Jonah is the problem, and they want to do something to him. "What should we do to you that the sea may be calm for us?" You know, should we hoist you on the mainsail, or, you know, what has to happen here? Notice this, the last phrase is what I like here, "for the sea was growing more tempestuous." If you want to have some fun in your Bible, it's not there in the Hebrew or anything, but just kind of fun to see what's happening here. There by the word sea, you could write the word God. Because I already learned in last week's Bible study that God is the one who's caused the storm to come upon Jonah and these mariners. And so the men are exceedingly afraid. They're asking Jonah what they should do with him. And God goes, let me turn it up to 11. Let's take this storm and just, you know, swirl it up a little bit more. Make the wind blow even harder. Notice the sea was growing more tempestuous. And that's not a ding against God. That is an incredible example of God's love for Jonah. Jonah, there's coming here into a moment into your life where there's an exit route off of the sinful, wicked, disobedient, rebellious path they're on. You have the opportunity to turn off from rebellion and to turn back into reconciliation and repentance with me. And these men are giving it to you. What shall we do to you that the sea may be calm for us? Oh, you want calm? Let me turn it up even more, because I want Jonah. And God is so faithful in his love to bring that into our lives, that when he sees us like Jonah walking in disobedience and rebellion to him, he goes, hey, there's an exit ramp coming up off this highway of rebellion, and I want you to take it. And so you know what? I'm going to make the storm even greater, because I want your heart. I want your life. I want your obedience. Jonah, verse 12, he said to the mariners, pick me up and throw me into the sea, then the sea will be calm for you. Oh, this is the way of a rebellious heart. Yeah, something needs to change here, but if it's going to change, someone else is going to have to do it. I'll change, I'll take the exit ramp, but you're going to have to force me into it. You want me gone, you're going to have to fire me. You want me gone, you're going to have to ask me to leave. You want me to do this, you're going to have to do it. I know what God is speaking to my heart, but I'm not going to pull the trigger myself because, well, oh my goodness, what would that take? Jonah, we so identify with him because he looks out at these mariners. Hey, why didn't Jonah just say, here, you know what? The problem is me. We all recognize the problem is me. I'm going over the side. I'll just climb up on the side and I'll jump in and the storm will go calm. You guys will be set free. God will take care of me and this will all end up out all right. But that's not the way of the rebellious heart. That's not the way of the spiritually blinded eyes. That's not the way of the disobedient. Now think about it for a moment, lest you think I overstate the case. Have you ever dealt with a rebellious child? And you ever had that child look at you and maybe put their hands on their hip? Or no, I'm not going to. And they know the correct way. They know the way of righteousness. You're a good parent. You've trained them and taught them in the things of the Lord. And yet, as you bring that truth into their life, their response isn't, oh, yeah, you're right. Hey, I want to do that. It's, no, you can't make me, or you'll have to, you know, whatever. It's Jonah. Oh, pick me up and throw me into the sea. Then the sea will be calm for you. Notice this. For I know that this great tempest is because of me. Is there a tempest in your family this morning? Is the tempest because of you? Is there a tempest on your job site? And the tempest is because of you? Is there a tempest in your church? And the tempest is because of you? And you know it, but have been unwilling to respond to the speaking of the Lord. Notice this. I know that this great tempest is because of me. Recognition is the first step to repentance. Recognition that there's a problem and the problem is me is the first step on the way to repentance. The world, well, they've... Actually, it was a Christian that originally put together the 12-step program, but the world has taken that and corrupted it the way the world does. But the steps of the 12-step plan, there's this recognition that, hey, there's a responsibility that starts with me. And if you look through God's word as he interacts with his people, each and every time there has to come a recognition from those that are followers of his. Hey, the issue first and foremost is right here with me. There may be sub-issues, there may be surrounding issues, but first right here, it's an issue of my heart. And you go, well, wait a minute. Again, I think you're overstating the case just a bit as it relates to Jonah. An issue of the heart? Oh, I take you back to Jonah chapter 4. Jonah says, I know that you're a gracious and merciful God, slow to anger and abundant in loving kindness, one who relents from doing harm. In other words, the last thing that God wanted to do was put Jonah in the center of a storm and get him tossed over the edge of the ship. And Jonah knew that, and yet he still rebelled. I know that this great tempest is because of me. I recognize that. Now, verse 13, it's such a sweet word that it starts with. I mean, this is a glorious word here. Nevertheless. See, what we're going to see here is we're going to see Gentiles, Jonah's Jewish. We're going to see Gentiles, unbelievers, pagans exhibit more compassion, ultimately more compassion than Jonah by the time we're done with the story, and you know it because you've read it. But we're going to see them exhibit compassion, which is just incredible. Nevertheless, Jonah says, pick me up and throw me in. The storm's all because of me. And the men go, no. Look it. Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to return to land. The phrase rowed hard in the Hebrew, it means to dig in. They were no longer just kind of, you know, is it like sculling, you know, when you're just, you know, on the edge of the water? I mean, they're digging in with those oars and they're doing everything they can to try and get that ship back to land. They're working even harder at it. I do think there's some kind of interesting irony here that these sailors, these Gentiles, they're digging in and they're working hard to try and rescue Jonah. They care more about Jonah than Jonah cares about Jonah. They rowed hard to return to land, but look at this. They could not, for the sea continued to grow more tempestuous against them. Again, there at the word sea, you could put the word God just to help you see, to help you understand, and it's God causing the sea to grow more tempestuous against them. Oh, this is that individual, they're that Jonah. And there they are in the storm, and you see the storm all around their life, and they're in a storm because they're living in rebellion to God. They're living in disobedience to God. And there in that storm, somebody comes into that storm and goes, oh, I love Jesus so much, and I love you so much. Let me just help you out in the midst of your storm. I'll buy you a new car. I'll put a new roof on your house. I'll give you a month of groceries. I'll get you a new job. We'll go out and buy you a whole new closet full of clothes. We're going to take care of you through this storm. And God goes, whoa, wait a minute. What are you doing? This is my storm for this individual to move them into the place where I need them to be. And you're messing with my storm. And God goes, all right. I'm going to turn it up another notch. Here we go to 15. Oh, we were at 11, weren't we? Another notch would be 12. Turn it up to 12. See, guys, if we rush in apart from seeing and hearing the Spirit of God into a life that we think is due on the verge for shipwreck, how do we know that God isn't going, wait a minute, what are you doing? This is my ship, my storm, my shipwreck, and my servant. Get back. I have work here that I'm doing. And I'm sorry to say that this has been a failure of the church for a very, very long time. Because we somehow have it in our head in the church. Oh, if you're in the church and you're walking with Jesus, you shouldn't have any problems. You shouldn't have any challenges. There shouldn't be anything going on. Everything should just be peachy keen and happy, good and peaceful and joyful and no problems at all. Except, you know what? We live in a sinful world and I get caught up in sin. I get caught up in rebellion. I get caught up in disobedience to God. And God comes along and goes, this is me stirring the waters. Makes a little storm. These men, they rowed hard to return to land, but they could not, for the sea continued to grow more tempestuous against them. I love asking somebody when they're in the midst of a storm, hey, let me ask you something. Where are you at in your devotions? Let's talk about prayer. What? Don't you know I need... No, I didn't want to talk about your needs right now. I want to talk about where you're at with the Lord. I want to talk about what's going on spiritually. Because, see, guys, we're living spiritual lives. In this world, in the church today, we're so tuned into the physical. Is everybody happy? Is everybody calm? Is everything okay? Does everyone have what they need? And yet there's a spiritual work that's being accomplished. And that's what's happening here with Jonah. And we go through Jonah and we go, oh yeah, Jonah, it's the story of Jonah and the big whale. No, it's a fish. And really, it's a spiritual story. It's four chapters of a spiritual work that God is accomplishing. And I would submit to you, and maybe you'll agree with me by the time we get to the end of the story, a spiritual work that God isn't seeking to accomplish in the Ninevites or in these mariners. But he's seeking to touch the heart of Jonah. Well, they could not get back to land. God made the sea grow more tempestuous against them. So the mariners, they cry out to the Lord. Is your Bible like mine? It's capital L, capital R, capital R, capital D. These Gentile pagans call out on Jehovah, the God of Israel? Are they converted? No, they're freaking out. There are no atheists in foxholes. It would seem there are no atheists on ships that are going down in the middle of storms caused by the prophet of God either. Look at this. Hey, okay, Jonah, you serve your God. We'll call to your God. We'll call out to any God that will save us. They cried out to the Lord, and we said, we pray, O Lord. Look at, they use the covenant name of God, Jehovah. We pray, O Jehovah, please do not let us perish for this man's life. Two things about this. The word life in Hebrew is soul. Yeah, they're concerned about his life, but they're concerned about his soul. See, there's been a recognition from time immemorial that life, it's here, it's gone. Everybody sees life, everybody sees death. The soul is eternal. An element that is eternal, that will either eternally spend time in separation from God in hell or spend eternity in heaven with God forever and ever. Please do not let us perish for this man's life. Notice here that these pagans, they are concerned about the soul of one single man. And yet in Nineveh, there are thousands, by some archaeological evidence, hundreds of thousands of souls that Jonah doesn't care about at all. God says, hey, I want you to go to Nineveh. Tell them judgment's coming upon them. No, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to go the opposite direction. Again, our mind is blown away when the world has more concern for one single man than the Christian has for thousands of people, they're going to be lost. And this is what's happening in the world today. I don't know about you, but I watch the liberal, left-wing, progressive cause. They are passionate. They are zealous. And they are accomplishing their purposes. Now, I'm not advocating a jump into politics. That's a different discussion for a different time. But what I am saying is they have a cause and a concern, whether you want to call it, you know, whatever you want to call it, and however they want to frame it, are we as zealous for the souls of the people of this world that will last for eternity, heaven or hell, as they are zealous for the souls of people who, apart from the Lord Jesus Christ, will spend an eternity in destruction for their causes? We pray, O Lord, please do not perish, let us perish for this man's life, and do not charge us with innocent blood. For you, O Lord, Jehovah, have done as it pleased you. And I wrote right here in my notes, yep, yep, and I'm good with that. That's fine with me. God, I want you to do in my life whatever you please, however you please, whenever you please. Christian, can you say that? Can you hold on to that? Does that own your heart? Or do you want to run the show until the show ain't looking so good and then you want God to take over? I hope your heart says, God, whatever you want to do, whenever you want to do it. Because that's the only way to be a follower of Jesus Christ. That I would deny myself, take up my cross and follow Jesus daily. you have to be in the place of allowing the Lord to do as it pleases him. Again, we stand in astonishment because these are unbelievers that are praying this prayer to God. God, have your way with us. They have more faith. They have more trust in God than Jonah does. God, we know if you do whatever you want to do, we're going to be okay. Verse 15, so they picked up Jonah and threw him into the sea. This is, again, another one of areas of scripture where I'm so very sorry we don't have things translated just a little bit differently. The word picked up is a Hebrew word, speaking of how this is accomplished. They picked him up with reverence and care. I always kind of imagined them making Jonah walk the plank. All right, sailor, get up on there. When you hit the end, keep on going. You know, you're out of here, and this storm is going to be all taken care of for us. Look at these hardened mariners. This is all happening in the midst of the storm. Notice verse 10, they're exceedingly afraid. Verse 12, they're in the midst of a great tempest. Verse 13, it's growing even more tempestuous against them. If it was me, man, I'll tell you what, I would have taken Jonah and with one heave-ho, he would have been gone. They picked him up with reverence and care. I'm not sure what that looks like. Jonah, could you please lay down here a minute on this, you know, pitching deck of the ship? I'm not sure what that means. I don't know that I need to know what it means. Maybe it's just speaking about their heart. Maybe it has nothing to do with the physicality of the surrounding situation. Maybe it's just their heart, that in their heart, as they're going to take this man and literally throw him overboard, in their heart is reverence and care for him. Watch in a minute, because here's what's happened up to this point. Jonah hasn't had any reverence and care for the people of Nineveh. And by the end of this story, Jonah is going to have more reverence and care for a plant that he didn't plant, that he didn't nurture, that he didn't cause to grow up, that died on him and inconvenienced him and really quite upset him and ruined his day. And I think, wow. What a great reminder for us as we minister to each other and minister to those around us that no matter the severity of the storm, no matter the depths of the rebellion and the disobedience of the individual, that we as God's representatives are to handle them with reverence and care. That goes always. The body of Christ, as we interact with each other, handling each other with reverence and care. Guys, I'm the first one. I am the first one to recognize that sometimes you just want to yell and scream and jump up and down and shake your fist and stomp your foot because of the corruption of sin and the depth of wickedness in my heart and the hearts of those that are around me. God, it's only by God's grace, it's only by the power of his Spirit that we function as the body of Christ. And we need to do so with reverence and care. Man, how many churches pick up the individuals in their congregation that are struggling in their sin and violently toss them overboard? Now, I see a lot of people jump. I can't do anything about jumpers. But when we have the opportunity to minister, when we have the opportunity to connect with somebody, to do it with reverence and care. Notice the response. And the sea ceased from its raging. Again, feel free to put God there. God went from 12, zero. All calm. All done. I can't even imagine how miraculous that had to be to go from a tempestuous sea that was growing more tempestuous, that these mariners were so afraid, and then bam, the sea stopped from its raging. Interesting, too, the way the Holy Spirit pens this for us. The sea stopped from its waving or its swelling. The sea stopped from, you know, sloshing back and forth. I like how the Holy Spirit just leaves us with this picture. It was a raging sea, and it stopped. Now, again, we know we're not overstating the case of the miraculous here, because look at the response of our mariners. Then the men feared the Lord exceedingly. They were already in awe of God that this storm had come up because of a man. Now that man gets tossed into the sea stops so fast that the men recognize, again, they are seeing a miracle. They are witness to the power and the presence of God over the course of nature. Incredible. Incredible. And guys, this is what feeds our faith. This is what feeds our walk and our trust and our belief in the Lord. When we see that storm in somebody's life and we look into their life and we see the rebellion and we see the disobedience and then we see the beginnings of repentance and we watch the storm go calm in their life, we're going, that's miraculous. Or be it in our own life, where we find ourselves off and away from the Lord doing our own thing and the storm is swirling around us and it's getting turned up 10, 11, 12. And then there's a recognition of our sin and there's a repentance from our sin. Things go calm because it could only be God. And we've interacted with the Creator of heaven and earth. Now, unfortunately, these men, back half of verse 16, they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and took vows. They did what they knew how to do. They offered a sacrifice and they took vows. Hey, you know what? When I get home, I am never going to. I will never again. I'm going to always do. And that's just a response of the flesh. That's how we can know if we've been touched by the Spirit of God. Do we respond in the flesh? Well, that was really something. Man, I'm never going to. No, God doesn't want to first change our behavior. He wants to first change our hearts. The spiritual response to a spiritual interaction with God is what we're going to get from Jonah in the next chapter. These men are pagans. They didn't get saved. They responded religiously to a supernatural experience. And the religious response is always, wow, man, that's incredible. I can't believe God did that in my life. You know what? I'm going to give him 6 months in children's ministry, and then, we'll be paid. We'll be even Stephen. I'm just saying that because I'm so thrilled because our children's ministry is open this morning. Praise the Lord. Hey, I've never given to God before, but, man, I'm going to write him a check for $1,000, and then we'll be all even up on this. You know, praise the Lord. That's not a relationship response. That's a religious response. You want to have a transaction with God, and God doesn't do transactions in the physical. God does transactions in the spiritual. Well, men, they feared the Lord exceedingly. They offered a sacrifice to the Lord, and they took vows. Verse 17, now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow Jonah. So we have a couple things to see here. First of all, that this Jehovah that has been spoken about, this Jehovah that has been prayed to, this Jehovah that has caused the storm and the calm, this Jehovah that has called Jonah, it is this Jehovah that prepared a great fish to swallow him. Notice the word prepared. It means appointed or assigned. I like to let my mind wander about. There's all these big fishies in the sea. And God goes, you, right there. Come on over here. Be prepared to get my servant, Jonah. I've assigned you. I've prepared you. If you want to even have some more fun with it, we're not going to get off into the details of this. And I'm sure you've seen some headlines in recent weeks about people who've been, swallowed by fish. But the fish needs to be of a certain size to accommodate a man and not kill him, and to be able to accommodate him for 3 days. So a larger experience than what happened supposedly recently here off of our East Coast. So for a fish to be that size, to accommodate Jonah inside of him for 3 days, that fish had to have been born a long, 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 long time ago. Isn't that kind of fun to think about? God, to the fish, before the foundations of the world, I knew you, and I called you, and I prepared you to swallow my servant Jonah. That's so good. You know, and if God can prepare a fish, in the case of Jonah, or he can prepare a talking donkey, in the case of Balaam, and he can prepare, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, throughout the scriptures, I have to look on at my life and go, wait a minute, what is God doing that he's already preparing for me? I don't have it yet. It hasn't come into my life yet, but he's prepared it back here. And that is one of the glorious things of walking with the Lord for a long period of time. Is you've walked with the Lord long enough to see that that thing that I prayed about 20 years ago, or that thing that I prayed about a week ago, God had already been preparing it 10 years ago. He'd already been preparing it 20 years ago. He was already designing it and preparing it for me. It says he prepared a great fish. Is it because it's great because it's large? Is it great because it's old? And notice that it's a fish. It's not a whale. I'm told there's a difference. All right, whatever. So it's a fish. Now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly. The Hebrew is actually the bowels. So Jonah wasn't in the fish's mouth. He wasn't stuck in his throat. The text is clear. Jonah was in the bowels of the fish 3 days and three nights. So when we think about Jonah, possibly, you know, when he's vomited out, his skin being bleached and him being covered with the residue of a whale's stomach, we haven't just created hyperbole. We're following the text. He was in the belly, in the bowels of the fish, 3 days and three nights. So watch this. The Lord God, who is the creator of life, the Lord God who can place inside of a woman a fertilized egg that at the moment of conception is life, and he can hold on to that life for 9 months while that life grows into a child that's ready to be born and to live on its own in this world, that God, I think he can also put a man in the bowels of a fish and cause him to survive for 3 days and three nights. I don't even have to think about it. I don't even have to consider it. It's not even an issue for me. And that's just one example of God's ability to create and to sustain life. So we want to get a running start on this. I don't really like where the chapter breaks are in Jonah. Wish it was kind of like all one chapter. Now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow. That's the second time I did that. Swallow Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. Do you see that next word? That is insanity. And just be straight up. That is spiritual insanity. See, Christian, if we're not careful, we can hold on to this thought that rebellion against God and against his word is really no big deal. God's a loving God, and he'll understand. Oh, he is a loving God. And he does understand. And he will still accomplish his purposes in my life. See, we can think that disobedience to God, it's not really a big deal. I remember a time in my life where my perspective was, if you looked at my life as being 10 pieces of a whole, you know what? These 9 pieces are rocking with Jesus right here. This 10th one, God's got the other. It's all good. All good. God's a God of grace. God's God of mercy. You know what? He's going to let me give him those nine, and I'm going to tithe that 1/10 section of my life. That's me. I can't give that part of the world up. I'm going to hold on to that right there. We can become so blind to those areas of rebellion and those areas of disobedience in our life that we can be in this place of Jonah. There are elements of my life at points in time that I could put my name right here. Then Tom. Are you kidding me? You are inside the bowels of a fish, and it takes you 3 days and 3 nights before you pray? You've lost your church. You've lost your wife. You've lost your kids. And you're still unwilling to pray? You've lost your job. You've lost your family. You've lost any credibility that you ever had for your Christian walk. And you're still unwilling to pray? Yeah, that's exactly where rebellion to God leads. Right into that place. Sometimes they spend time thinking about Jonah. How did those 3 days go? Now, we're going to find out if we get there today. We're going to find out that Jonah, he wasn't passed out for 3 days. It's not like he went into the fish's mouth and got pushed down into the belly and he passed out. And 3 days later, he woke up and went, whoa, prayer. No, Jonah was conscious the entire time. He speaks about his experience in his prayer. 3 days. What do you think about? Maybe a better question would be, how did he argue? Did he grumble against God? Did he spend 3 days complaining? Did he spend 3 days blame shifting? Oh, I can't believe those sailors did this. Oh, I can't believe that captain wouldn't let me on that other ship. There were two ships going to Tarshish, and I had to pick this one. Did he spend 3 days making it everybody else's fault except his own? Again, lest you think I overstate, look at the next two words. Jonah prayed. This is the first mention of Jonah praying in this entire saga. The pagans, those who don't not know the Lord God, creator of heaven and earth, they prayed back in verse 14. For Jonah, no prayer at the time that God called him to go do the task he was asking him to do. No prayer at the time that he rebelled and went the opposite direction from what God was asking him to do. No prayer from Jonah in the midst of the storm. In fact, you remember the captain came to Jonah and said, hey, what are you doing, sleeper? Get up and call upon your God. Jonah even rebelled against the captain. I think his name was Steubing. Great guy. Anyway, do you know that he was a Christian, Captain Steubing? He's a born-again believer. You're going to see him in heaven. Got saved after his love boat days, I think. It's very nice. Anyway, back to Jonah. Then Jonah prayed. I do think the next phrase is insightful as well. He prayed to the Lord. See, what happens is if I don't guard my heart in the midst of the storm, in the belly of the fish, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to pray about my wife. I'm going to pray about my kids. I'm going to pray about my job. I'm going to pray about my pastor. I'm going to pray about my stupid, stinking life. And none of those things accomplish anything. Nothing. Jonah, he got it right. He prayed to the Lord. And I even like this, that Jonah didn't pray about the Lord. Because sometimes I do that. God, I can see I'm in the storm. God, I can see I'm in the belly of the fish. And you know what? I can't believe you're doing this to me. You say you love me. Your Bible says that you'll never leave me or forsake me. And I got to tell you, like right now, I feel really forsaken. That's not really the prayer that God is looking for. That's not the communication, the fellowship, the koinonia that the creator of the world and the savior of my soul is quite looking for. Jonah, he prayed to the Lord. But it gets even better. He prayed to his God. He prayed to the Lord, his God. It expresses ownership. It expresses relationship. Again, if you look at the text, he prays to the Lord, his God. That phrase, his God, doesn't appear anywhere else in the text up until this point. Because you know what? When I'm running from God, it's real hard to say, oh yeah, he's my God, we're like this. Oh, he's my God, we're like this. In fact, right now we're like this. No, Jonah prayed to the Lord, his God, from the fish's belly. I look at that and I go, and this is somewhat related to then at the front end of the verse, but I think it brings a little bit of a different context to it. Then Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from the fish's belly. I wrote here in my notes, I wrote, really? Question mark. Is this where we need to be to do our best praying? Or to pray at all? I went through that season of life as well, early on in my Christian walk. I wasn't in a church like you guys are in where you're being taught God's word verse by verse. I was having to read the Bible, and it was taking me a long time to read and to learn. It was quite overwhelming in the early days. I was very hungry. The Holy Spirit was teaching me, but that's a process. There's 66 books to get through, and so you're learning from the Lord. And as I'm making my way through and I'm not getting the instruction and the teaching, I'm just, you know, waiting upon the Lord. And it kind of looks to me like I read the Bible. Hey, if God knows everything and God knows where I'm at and he knows what's in my heart and he knows what's going on around me, then I don't really need to pray because God already knows. So you know what? I'm not going to pray because God already knows. And I mean, if something comes, well, if there's a really big, well, I mean, if I end up in the belly of a fish, then I'll pray. You see how that happens? Failing to see that prayer has nothing to do with God and everything to do with me. Prayer's about changing my heart. Prayer's about changing my perspective. Prayer's about changing me. Prayer's about God reaching down into my life and refreshing me and speaking to me and ministering to me. And that when I'm in a group situation praying, he's doing that within the group, because where two or three are gathered together, there he is in their midst. And where two or three agree on anything, God accomplishes that purposes, those purposes for them and for him. It was a number of years ago that we had a discussion in a leadership meeting. I want to say it was maybe a decade ago now, something like that. We had a discussion in a leadership meeting. We said, you know, here's what we're going to do. As we interact with the flock and we're ministering to people and there's challenges in their life, they're finding themselves in storms, here's what we're going to do. We're going to minister to them in the storm, and then we're going to invite them to come to prayer to pray about the issue going on in their life. You know what I watched happen? People stopped sharing with me about their storms. And it happened across the board. Now, we weren't signing people up. We weren't forcing them to do anything. Just, hey, why don't you come to prayer? You know what? You should fill out a prayer card if you can't be there on Thursday night. Would like to pray for your situation. Yeah. I'm going to have to do that. See, I think one of the reasons that we like Jonah so much is we read through the book of Jonah, and the application and the illustration for our own life is so incredible and so powerful. And today, you know, unfortunately, as the last last Sunday was as well, and I apologize for that. We got two Sundays here where it's, you know, it's about Jonah's rebellion and his disobedience. And so, you know, I'm trusting you guys that you've read the story and you know the story, and there's a really beautiful pivot that comes up here in John chapter 2, because otherwise, Jonah chapter 2, because otherwise, you know, it sounds like I'm just going to spend, you know, the next couple of weeks ragging on Jonah and telling us all what sinners and heathens and rebellious people we are. And that's not my heart at all, and that's not God's heart, but that is the passage up to this point. It took Jonah 3 days to pray, and Jonah didn't pray until he ended up in the fish's belly. And he said, Jonah said, and I want you to see this, and this is how we're going to close. What I'm going to do is I'm going to read through his prayer, and then I'm going to close, because the clock says I have to. And I want you to see as I read through the prayer, and I'm going to take it at a comfortable pace. I want you to see that Jonah does not cry out for deliverance. It's fascinating. If it was me, and it took me 3 days to pray, and I had to be confined to the bowels of a fish before I prayed, I'm thinking the first words once I came to that place of brokenness, submission, and surrender before the Lord to even call on him, my first words would have been, God, get me out of here. See, this humbles me, because what I see is I've spent 2 hours bashing Jonah, and he is possibly a more powerful follower of God than I ever will be. And that freaks me out, because Jonah doesn't pray, get me out of here. Jonah thanks God for saving him. And I go, you know, I was in a pretty serious, expensive trial 2 weeks ago, and God taught me amazing things. Thursday morning at 5:30 a.m., a strong line of storms went through Grand Rapids and blew out all our internet connections for streaming the service today. No problem. That's fine. Don't need God. We've contracted with a company. The leaders of the church, man, they blessed me so much. A year ago, I said, guys, I just can't do it anymore. It's so beyond my knowledge base. I need help. And so we contracted with a company. So I call up the company. Hey, so I said, hey, I'm throwing up the bat signal. Need help. And the guy goes, yeah, this is pretty inconvenient. My son and I are in Dallas all weekend. No, you don't understand. I have to have internet by Sunday morning. Yeah, well, we're in Dallas. I think we can probably get you up and going, but you're going to have to do the work. So I did. Spent a good chunk of Friday and a bit of Saturday trying to get all the equipment put back together, doing stuff. I have no idea what to do. I'm just sitting there on the phone going, okay, touch this, put in this number, you know, dial this up, connect this wire, and now it works. And in the middle of the storm, oh, I was asking God for deliverance. But I wasn't thanking him for saving us. And the internet's up and running now. People are watching from home, praise the Lord. I think, Jonah, you're the man. You know what? You're the man. And sometimes, Jonah, you mess up really bad. But at the core of your being, you're the man. And you're the man because of the work that God has done in your life. Now, we know the story of Jonah. There's going to be some challenges here before the book is out, and we'll work on that when we get there. But at this moment, we're astounded by this. I cried out to the Lord because of my affliction, and he answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol, I cried, and you, Lord, heard my voice. For you, Lord, cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the floods surrounded me. All your billows and your waves passed over me. Then I said, I have been cast out of your sight. Yet I will look again toward your holy temple. The waters surrounded me, even to my soul. The deep closed around me. Weeds were wrapped around my head. I went down to the moorings of the mountains. The earth with its bars closed behind me forever. Yet you, Lord, have brought up my life from the grave. O Lord, my God, when my soul fainted within me, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer went up to you into your holy temple. Those who regard worthless idols forsake their own mercy. But I will sacrifice to you, Lord, with the voice of thanksgiving. I will pay what I have vowed. Salvation is of the Lord. For I know that you are a gracious and merciful God, slow to anger, and abundant in loving kindness, and one who relents from doing harm. Father, for those this morning who find themselves in the midst of the storm, we would pray, Lord, that you would surrender to the spiritual work that you're doing and trust themselves to your care. Give you praise and thanksgiving for your salvation. And watch you do your greatest work. Thank you, Lord, that by your Spirit, even in the midst of the storm, in reverence and care, you handle us. But you continue to handle us till you accomplish your purposes. And we're so very, very grateful for that. Lord, for the heart that needs to repent, Father, may they take the off-ramp that you're providing. Maybe the years of excuses, years of blame shifting, the years of ducking ownership and leadership. The years of pride and rebellion and disobedience would cease on this Father's Day. They would find themselves submitting and surrendering, maybe afresh and anew, maybe for the first time, to your Lordship in their life. Father, I think of the ones listening or tuning in that because they don't know you as Lord and Savior, they're hearing your Holy Spirit identify the sin and the rebellion in their life. It's not a rebellion to your fatherhood, it's a rebellion to the convicting work of your Holy Spirit. They know they're living in sin. They know they don't belong to you. They know their goodness isn't going to get them into heaven. Father, today I pray would be a day that they would repent of their sin and ask you to be their Heavenly Father and ask you to be the Savior of their soul and the Lord of their life. And you will be their friend forever. What a good friend you are. Father, for those of us that don't find ourselves in the place of unsaved and we don't find ourselves living in the place of the rebellion of Jonah, Father, build up and even more firmly establish within us, Lord, our faith and our trust and our belief in you. That no matter what storms we find ourselves in, because you've allowed them to come into our life, that in the midst of the storm, we would thank you for the salvation. We would thank you for the resolution that you have brought. We would thank you that your plans and purposes will be accomplished, because as we learned here from Jonah, you always do what pleases you. And you know what, Lord? That really pleases us as well. And so have your way with us. You are the potter. We are the clay. Mold us and shape us into the means, into the way that would bring the most honor, the most glory to you, to your kingdom, and to your purposes. Father, thank you for hearing our hearts in prayer this morning. Thank you for speaking to us through your word. Thank you for the dozens of conversations that happened here over the last hour that had nothing to do with this conversation other than being birthed out of Jonah. Father, may those conversations bring even greater spiritual fruit. Again, for your honor and for your glory. We love you, Lord Jesus. We thank you for your word. We thank you for our salvation. We thank you that you are our Father. We love you and we bless you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.